As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, so says the Lord. Good morning. My name is Reverend Louise Hart, and I'd like to welcome you to this service here at First Wesley United Church in Thunder Bay. We welcome you all together as we gather as a virtual community. Some of us sit together in the same room. We are in different cities and towns, in different places, but we are all gathered together in spirit, all of us united in our desire to mourn and to give thanks for the life of Sharon Elizabeth Robinson. It's a tough job to say goodbye to someone you love, and in this time of pandemic, It's not possible for us to gather as we normally would, safe together within the walls of our beloved church sanctuary. While we miss the times when this was possible, we give thanks for the miracle of technology that brings us together in ways that once were unimaginable. Gathered in spirit, let us pray. Loving God, you brought us to life, and you remind us that death is a natural part of life. We come this morning to celebrate the life of Sharon Elizabeth Robinson, a person who we have known and loved, a mother, a wife, a grandmother, a friend, a member of this church. We give you thanks, Lord, for the whole range of human experience that was hers, the wonder, the joys, and the challenges. Bless us in these moments of remembering that we may express our loss and comfort one another. We pray in the name of the compassionate one, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hello, and thank you for joining us today. I wanted to take a few minutes before I start my eulogy and just thank a few people. And first of all, thank you to all of you for taking the time and joining the service. Second of all, I just want to thank Pastor Louise for doing something a little bit different with us, and we really appreciate your input and your help. I also want to thank Sergeant and Sons, particularly Greg, for your patience and your guidance as we navigated this difficult time. I also wanted to acknowledge that directly after this service, we will be heading out, a few of us. It's a very private service at the cemetery. We can only have so many people there, but I wanted to acknowledge the pallbearers that we have chosen, and my mom would have been thrilled to know that Peter, David, and Andrew Lado and my son Benjamin will be acting as our pallbearers at the cemetery after this service, so thank you to all four of you. Finally, my brother is not in the same room as me, as you probably know by now. He and his family are in Ottawa, and he's really worked hard in the last couple of weeks to make this service possible. So I just wanted to thank him for his energy and his ideas. I think this is a really, really great way of doing it. So Jeff and I decided that we wanted to do something special and unique for our mom. We chose to make lemonade out of some really sour, rotten lemons. We hope that you will enjoy this special tribute to our mom. It's not your typical funeral service. We get it. We understand that. We always thought that our mom's funeral would be at Wesley United Church, where she was baptized, where she attended Sunday school as a youngster, where she was part of the youth group in her teens. Sharon was part of a church group there in her adult life, and it was also where she was married. I hope you all enjoyed seeing Pastor Louise in the setting there at Wesley. Although we're not all there together, we thought that it was a very important part of her life and wanted it to be part of her special day. One of the super cool things about doing the service the way we have done it is that we're able to share Sharon's legacy with you in a variety of different ways. As you can imagine, cards and letters and emails started pouring in after the news got around that Sharon had died. Before I begin my eulogy, we wanted to share some of those cards with you that we received from people over the last month. These cards were so helpful to me at a time when I could not, and still have not, gotten a real hug from anyone other than my immediate family. These cards were my warm hug and my virtual embrace, and I thank you. We got so many of them. We're just going to share a few of them with you. These cards also gave me a really strong direction for the eulogy. You'll see in a moment there's a common theme weaved throughout them all. And Sharon's youngest granddaughter will now share some of these cards and emails with you.
Hi, I'm Callie, and I'm happy to share these stories with you today. The first one is an email. Dear Sherry, I always loved your mom when we were students at the University of Guelph for her energy. joie de vivre, forth righteousness and irreverence. We had plenty of fun together, and I learned lots about God's country from her. We send our sincere sympathy to your family and wish you comfort and peace. Stay safe. Warmly, Marion and Bill Birdsall. We have such fond memories of her from Westgate days, both as a student and as a fellow teacher. She was such a wonderful, fun, and vibrant teacher and old family friend. Deepest sympathies, Lal and Susan Nanskeville. Your mom and Nana was such an amazing lady. She always made everything fun and special. I am so grateful to have had her as my aunt next door. We will always miss her and think of her often, smiling at the fun memories. Please know you are in our hearts. Love, Jen, Brad, Jane, and Amy. We made a donation to the Alzheimer's Society in your mom's memory. I know your memories will sustain for you and your family. For Mac 62 gals, Sharon will always be Smitty and such a fun gal to be with. God bless. Love, Ann Mogan. I remember how vibrant, friendly, and joyful Sharon was when I first met her during Barb and John's wedding festivities. With love and deepest sympathies, Patty and Marty Philp. Thank you.
To everything, there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. What profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also he hath set the world in their heart, so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from the beginning to the end. I know that there is no good in them, but for a man to rejoice and do good in his life. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 through 12.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all
get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all
get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
When we all
see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
Scripture reading from Isaiah chapter 43, verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep you over. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze.
Scripture reading from Psalms 23, verses 1 to 4. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
Today, I am not going to talk about Alzheimer's disease. We have spent the last 13 and a half years talking about that. Today, I want to remember and honor my mom, Sharon Elizabeth Robinson, the daughter, the sister, the wife, the aunt, the teacher, the friend, my beloved mom, and grandmother. I'm going to share some stories with you, and hopefully you'll be giggling at home. My cousin Maureen and I had a conversation a few days before my mom died, and she said to me that my mom really had a charmed life, and I think she did. She was born in 1939 to two adoring parents, Fred and Flora Smith, who were both educated and well-employed. She grew up in an affluent area of Fort William. If you can see that picture of her in the carriage with the big fluffy white bonnet on, you can tell she was well cared for. She was a figure skater, attended church on Sundays, had a room full of dolls, always got a new Easter outfit, and was part of many family functions and parties. Her older sister Barbara always referred to her as the spoiled brat. My mom loved attending school as a young person, and she was a self-professed teacher's pet. At the age of 5 or 6, Sharon's parents bought a property at Amethyst Harbor. Sharon spent all of her summers at this camp at Amethyst Harbor, and it became a part of her spirit and her being. She participated in the sports program, won the mile swim trophy. She was the instructor out there for 5 summers and created many close summer and lifelong friendships out there. She received the name Gertie. The story goes that one summer they were all sitting around trying to talk about the name that they would never want to be called. And for whatever reason, my mom did not want to be called Gertrude, so her name was Gertie. All through public and high school, Sharon had a great group of girlfriends, many of them watching this podcast today in various parts of the province. These high school friends would still get together over the years, usually every summer out at Silver Islet, Susie Greer's camp. Additionally, they would come to the house just to visit my mom. One of these lifelong friends also became her lifelong next door neighbor. Before children, my parents bought the house next to Auntie Myrna and Uncle Richard. Auntie Myrna, your lifelong friendship meant so much to her. You and she both built family traditions like Christmas Day visiting, New Year's Day birthday celebrations, other birthdays, and family dinners. She often would say, "I don't know what I would do without my Myrna." After high school, Sharon attended the University of Guelph, obtaining a degree in home sciences, and then the University of Toronto to obtain her 1-year teaching degree. At her beloved University of Guelph, she met another group of lifelong friends, many of whom, again, are listening today. This close-knit group of ladies were known as MAC 62. She was very involved in the university, and she was elected the girls' athletic president in her final year, something I know she was very proud of. I do always remember my mom escaping to Toronto or London or Guelph to visit Mary McGowan or Ann Alton or to attend a MAC 62 reunion. Many of her classmates from Max 62 have written to me over the last month, again, all saying the same thing. Your mom was full of joy, full of fun, sense of humor, planner of the fun. One of the things that I found out through these letters, though, was that in her final year, my mom planned a trip for 3 cars full of friends to come to Fort William after their graduation. This group of gals apparently stayed at Amethyst, at the camp at Amethyst, and had to cart water in from the lake. They all have fond memories of this trip. Sharon apparently would brag about God's country, referring to the Thunder Bay area, and they remember her being so proud of her roots. This group of Max 62 graduates have honored my mom with a tree being planted in her name at a special service on September 20th. Both Jeff and I attended the University of Guelph, and now her grandson Jordan is attending that university and will attend the service on September 20th on behalf of his Nana. As we can all attest, Sharon had friends wherever she went, and one of her greatest friends was Wayne Robinson. She met Wayne Robinson in grade school at Isabella Street School. As a youngster, they attended the youth group with Reverend Greeno and Reverend McLeod in their teens, and they attended FWCI together. She said that they started to flirt in grade 13. When she went away to, she would go away to university every fall, and they would get back together every summer. She fell in love with his sense of humor and his tremendous devotion to her. They were married in the university, or after university, in 1954. And Wayne is listening to this service right now. So I want to say to him, Dad, Mom is in a better place. She loved you so much. She loved her wonderful 50 plus years of marriage to you. She loved raising your children together. She loved the travels that you had together to Arizona, Florida, New Zealand, Branson. She loved sharing the many memories you had. And she also knows that you were with her in her final days, and she loves you to the moon and back for doing that for her. As I mentioned earlier, Auntie Barbara was 6 years older than my mom. So when my mom got married, she already had 4 of her 5 children. My mom loved her nieces and nephews and was a great aunt. She attended hockey games, football games, basketball games, and she was always very interested in John Grace's girlfriends. She was so proud of her flower girl, Maureen, who became a doctor. And my cousin Barb stayed for many summers out at our camp and was more like a daughter to her than a niece. Thank you to all my cousins for reaching out over the last month to check in on Jeff and I. It's very much appreciated. Sharon was a teacher. As many teachers do, they touch some students more than others. I have met 2 women in our community during my career who were touched by my mom in very profound ways. One woman told me a story that when she was in high school, she found herself pregnant and her family had turned her away. She told me if it were not for my mom helping her, she did not know what she would do. I also met another woman who tells me a story of my mom fighting to get her into a fashion co-op. This co-op changed the direction of this woman's life, and she's now a successful business owner in Thunder Bay. I also have a few very close friends who had my mom for a teacher, and they all tell me she was one of the most fun teachers they ever had. Sharon has 1,000 friends, and I think it is because of her friendly, positive, joyful personality. I hated grocery shopping with my mom as a kid because you'd always bump into a student or a friend and she'd have to talk and talk and talk. A quick in-and-out trip would easily turn into an hour. She was a fun friend. She was always entertaining. She had a great sense of humor. She was always planning a party, or looking for a party, or participating in the fun. There was one infamous story of Sharon at a party at Leto's Deck. Next door, at the Joneses camp, there was also a party going on of a much younger generation. There was a young girl at the Jones party doing cartwheels in her bathing suit and getting lots of attention from the men on both decks. Well, Sharon decided that if the cartwheels was what it was going to take to get some attention, then cartwheels is what she was going to do. So off she goes to the grass and proceeds to try and do some cartwheels, but at 50 years of age, that didn't go very well. So she enlisted some help of some of her male friends who grabbed her feet and helped her to complete a cartwheel. She finally completed the cartwheel and got accolades again from both parties at both decks. At camp, the Latos were our next door neighbor. And Paul Lato used to sit at his table and look through the window every Sunday morning for his underworked, overpaid schoolteacher friend. As soon as he saw her coming, he'd close the curtains as if to say, "Don't come in, Sharon." But if she didn't show up, he would wonder where she was. I want to take this time in particular to thank the Ladigan sisters from Amethyst, Bonnie and Sandy, who carried on almost weekly visits to Sharon at Roseview until the end. You both showed what true friendship is all about. Thank you. As I mentioned earlier, Sharon was part of a church group for most of her adult life through Wesley Church. She loved these ladies in that church group. I do not know how often they prayed together, but they definitely had fun together, and they did good deeds for the church together. Every year they put on the lunch for the church bazaar, and they had to do one craft to make the decorations for the table at the luncheons. Well, her church group members will remember well that Sharon was not the crafty type. You would all have to fix her handiwork, but she more than made up for it in the kitchen for the luncheons. Her partner in teaching, Jackie Black, would also agree. Jackie taught the sewing part of the family studies course, and Sharon hated to sew, but she loved to cook and bake, so she taught that part of the course. Sharon was known for her cooking and her baking and her entertaining. Many of you listening will remember she was a great party host. Sometimes the menu would be turned into a different language so that the guests did not know what they were ordering and didn't know when they would be served what. Sometimes my mom would plan a spaghetti dinner and she would only set the table with weird utensils you had to use, like a potato masher to eat your spaghetti with. Sometimes Santa would show up in July. Sometimes party would be planned to honor a dear friend's birthday. All the while, the wine would flow and the party ended up with a lot of laughter and great memories. She planned parties like this all the time. A lot of my memories of my mom was her in the kitchen with her apron on, making and preparing for a family supper, a birthday surprise, or for someone getting ready for a church group or church group function, or preparing for the next party. I know for certainty that my mom knew what she was doing on March 15th when she decided to stop eating and entering her end-of-life journey. She knew we were heading into unprecedented times. She knew the party was over, the doors were closing, and there were no more visitors. She knew that it was time to go, that fun was over. My mom, I want to talk about her being a mom. My daughter, Abby, made me a card recently for my birthday, and it read, "To the mom that everyone wishes they had, how lucky I am to have gotten you." That card will mean more to me than ever because that rings true for me. I too had the mom that everyone wished they had. As a mom, there are just so many things to remember about the type of mom that she was. Jeff and I knew, without a shadow of a doubt, that we were loved. She was a true mother to her core, even through the dementia. The day I left for Cuba, I went to feed her breakfast and I held her hand and she would still stroke my hand with her thumb. Her eyes weren't even open, but her mother instincts would still check in. Jeff and I were both tucked in every night as youngsters, and every night she would take time to talk to each one of us separately and tickle our backs. She was always there for my brother and I. When Jeff's best friend was killed in a car accident the summer after his grade 13 year, she was there for him, going the extra mile to make sure he was supported, even calling ahead to the university to inform the dean of his program to make sure they knew what Jeff was dealing with. Our living room was the gathering place for the NBA basketball games for Jeff and his friends. Our house was the place kids came for cooking lessons, where we would host concerts, musical concerts for my parents, and where we would just hang out. My mom knew all of our friends, and all of our friends knew her. She joked with our friends, she knew information about them, and she loved to hold conversations with them. She was very interested in people's personal lives. She wanted to know everything. On one particular teenage evening, Jeff and I had friends over to the house before a dance. My parents had gone out to dinner and a movie. As soon as they left, friends arrived. Wayne and Sharon decided to come home between the dinner and movie, though, and her friends had been drinking in the living room. When my parents pulled in the driveway, Jeff and I yelled, "Hide!" So booze was hidden behind curtains and friends hid in all corners of the house. Sharon came in the back door and knew friends were hiding because their cars were in the driveway. And instead of getting mad, she hollered for everyone to come out of hiding and she told them they were all welcome anytime. I just remember the nervous laughter coming from everyone as they were pleasantly surprised by her reaction. Sharon taught at Westgate and Jeff and I attended Westgate. Jeffy was her golden boy. Jeffy could do no wrong in high school, and everyone knew that. I was the black sheep. There were a few teenagers that I could do no right in her eyes, but all that changed when I went away to university, when I matured and got married myself. She became one of my best friends. I remember calling her sometimes 2 or 3 times a day. I am convinced God gave her Alzheimer's disease because he knew I could only handle losing her a spoonful at a time. I have been able to say goodbye to her slowly over the last 13 years. I wanted to talk about her being a grandmother till the very end because this was her favorite thing to be. She always said, "I could never imagine loving somebody more than my own children until I had grandchildren." And she had 6 grandchildren that she loved very much. Jordan, you came first. And for that, you held a very, very special place in Nana's heart. You made her a grandmother for the very first time. She carried pictures around everywhere she went and probably drove her friends crazy. Next came Benjamin. Benjamin was the cutest, according to Nana. Benjamin, if you had a quarter for every time she called you cute, you would have all the investment money you ever wanted. Oliver was the third to arrive. Nana would be so proud of the person you are becoming, Oliver. Your strength of character is admirable, and she always loved your rascally ways. Abby arrived 2 months after Oliver. Abby, Nana knew since you were 18 months old with your teacher's stick in your hand and learning to read before you were 2 that you were going to be a teacher. And she would be over the moon happy knowing what you were doing this fall. Callie Jo from Kokomo and Justin came 6 days apart, and whoa, Nana did not know what to do with that. She did not know whether to stay in Thunder Bay or get down to Ottawa. Callie, you and Nana always had tea parties together. She loved your crazy side, and you often had her and Papa laughing. Justin, I always remember hearing Anna talking to your mom on the phone. She would always say with a little giggle, "And what's Justin up to now?" Because you were a going concern, involved in everything. Nana loved her trips to Ottawa, sitting in hockey rinks, going to the barn, making cookies and macaroni and cheese. She loved getting her weekly updates from your mom and your dad over the phone. I do want to take a moment to pause here because I know Nana would want me to do this. She would want me to thank Ben and Abby and Callie in particular. You have to share your mother with Nana for 13 years. At times it has not been easy, but the three of you never complained. You have grown up to be three of the most compassionate people I know. The three of you visited her after school, pushed her in wheelchairs down the hall, fed her meals at the end, and did things for a Nana that most kids should never have to do. You are amazing, and she would want to say thank you. I know my mom is in a better place. Jeff and I take great peace in that. I also take great pride and peace in knowing of the great legacy that this woman left behind. She left joyful memories. She touched many people's lives with her vibrant, friendly personality. And she left the love of a family that will be felt for generations to come. Goodbye, Mom. Jeff and I were the luckiest kids on earth to have a mom like you.
God is good all the time. Start of day, dark of night, God is good all the time, all the time. This is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in
I'd like to share a reflection with you. We gather here to say goodbye and to remember Sharon Elizabeth Robinson. When we say goodbye, I like to remind myself that goodbye also means God be with you. God is with Sharon. The thin veil that separates heaven from earth has ceased to exist for her, and she is with God in a place where there is no more separation and no more tears, in a place that God promises us there is a room prepared for us. In mourning Sharon, we take comfort from God's promise that death is not the end, that this separation is not permanent. We say goodbye knowing that Sharon's life was a blessing to many. Sharon was an active member of Wesley United Church, which is now known as First Wesley after an amalgamation with Knox and First United Churches. Sharon is well remembered by her congregation, despite having been absent from worship for many years due to Alzheimer's disease. The years away cannot erase the years that she was here in this church. She was a big part of the life and work of this church. Sharon was a member of the Naomi Ruth UCW group, and she took part in all their activities and was especially known for her work in the bazaar. We give thanks for Sharon's purposeful life. We think of Sharon's family who miss her dearly. We think of Wayne, Sharon's husband of 55 years, and her son Jeff and her daughter Sherry. We think of their partners and all the grandchildren, Jordan, Oliver, Justin, Benjamin, Abby, and Kali. Family was important to Sharon, and she loved her family dearly. We know that all of you would wish to be here, but with the restrictions on travel and the limited number of people who are allowed to gather due to COVID-19, we cannot. You are grateful that you are here with us in spirit, connected by your love of Sharon and the Spirit of God that unites us all. For everything, there is a season. As the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes reminds us, there is a time to be born and a time to die. This is the time to say a final goodbye to Sharon. God has been with her from the day of her birth to the very end of her life, and God is with her now. Today would have been her birthday, and we can celebrate the good news that Sharon is with God. We remember the blessings that Sharon offered in her life's work. She was a gifted teacher, and that she had a wonderful and positive influence on the lives of her many students, and of course, on her family. Sharon's fruitful life has come to an end. The unchanging cycle of the seasons is over for her. This is the time to remember that the love of God embraces us all through all the seasons of life and goes with us beyond the horizon we call death. It is a time to mourn, but as the writer of Ecclesiastes suggests, it is also a time to dance. Mixed in with our mourning is our remembering. As you remember the person she was, you will find cause to celebrate her life. Remember her smiles. Remember her sayings. Remember the time spent at Amethyst Harbor. Remember the theme parties, being in the kitchen with her, or sitting around a well-set table with her. Talk of the times that she was with you, what she did and what she said. Get out the photo albums and share stories. Sharon is lost from your sight, but she is not lost to God. John, the gospel writer, talks of a seed being sown into the ground. Is the seed lost forever because it is out of sight? Not at all. It is there all the time, unseen, but ready to flower in a wonderful and unexpected way. This is one of the ways of explaining the resurrection. Life does not come to an end when death happens. It goes on, from birth to death to life eternal. That is the path of Jesus, and thanks to Jesus and the sacrifice that he made on the cross, it is our path too. Thanks be to God. We are an Easter people. Amen.
How can I love when I'm afraid to fall? But watching you stand alone, all of my doubts suddenly go away somehow. One step closer, I have died every day waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid, I've loved you for a thousand years. I love you for a thousand more. Time stands still, beauty in all she is. I will be brave, I will not let
I put together a sestina, which is a poem using the same six words in a sequence at the end of each line. I chose the six words that best represent my mom to me: family, friends, camp, water, and active. It's simply called My Mom. She would say, "Be nice. You only have one family. Make sure you appreciate your friends. Include them in your life and be active. Carry them with you in a song. They are as precious as water. Someday you will need them in your camp. Oh, how special life was for Mom at camp, watching her grandchildren and family, enjoying days on the water, racing, biking, fishing, playing with friends. Movements as beautiful as a song. Vibrant, sharing, wonderful, active. Teaching her children to go out there and be active. Our biggest cheerleader forever in our camp. Always singing the happy birthday song and being social with her family. Organizing hot chocolate with our friends after an evening on frozen water. Watching thunderstorms and rainwater falling from the sky that is so active. Is everyone safe in the camp? She was sure to keep the foe away from the family. Let's play board games with friends and watch the lightning dance like a song. Listening, learning, and loving her song. She kept us above water. Taught us the importance of family, kept the love in our life active, made sure we were in the right camp, and relying on faith and friends. Arguing with Flora, yet remaining friends. Loving music, but deaf tone in a song. Remembering good moments at camp, like Wayne heading out on the water. We were all so busy and active, but never so for family. Keep many friends and stay from threatening water. Continue her love in a song and remember to stay active. Know Sharon will always include you in her camp and she will always embrace you in her family.
And now, as we say our final farewell, we say words of commendation. Into your hands, Lord, we commend your servant Sharon. Welcome her into the beauty of eternal tranquility, in that place where there is no more sorrow or separation or mourning or tears. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a daughter of your own redeeming. Let us pray the words of the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'd like to conclude with a blessing. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and the rains fall softly upon your fields. And may you find yourself always in God's welcoming arms. Go in peace. Amen.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home. calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh, for the wonderful love he has promised, promised for you and for me. Has mercy and pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come. Calling, oh sinner, come.